Harper Audio presents The Lace Reader by Brunonia Barry. Performed by Alyssa Bresnahan. Copyright 2006 by Brunonia Barry. Production copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers. Part 1. The lace reader must stare at the piece of lace until the pattern blurs and the face of the seeker disappears completely behind the veil. When the eyes begin to fill with tears and the patience is long exhausted, there will appear a glimpse of something not quite seen. In this moment, an image will begin to form in the space between what is real and what is only imagined. The Lace Reader's Guide. Chapter 1. My name is Towner Whitney. No, that's not exactly true. My real first name is Sophia. Never believe me. I lie all the time. I am a crazy woman. That last part is true. My little brother Beezer, who is kinder than I, says the craziness is genetic. We're from 5 generations of crazy, he says. As if it were a badge he's proud to wear, though he admits that I may have taken it to a new level. Until I came along, the Whitney family was what the city of Salem fondly refers to as quirky. If you were old Salem money, even if that money was long gone, you were never referred to as crazy. You might be deemed unusual or even oddball, but the hands-down favorite word for such a condition was quirky. Throughout the generations, the Whitney men have all become famous for their quirks, from the captains of sea and industry, all the way down to my little brother, Beezer, who is well known within scientific circles for his articles on particle physics and string theory. Our great-great-grandfather, for example, parlayed a crippling preoccupation with ladies' feet into a brilliant career as a captain of industry in Lynn's thriving shoe business, creating a company that was passed down through the generations all the way to my grandfather, G.G. Whitney. Our great-great-great-grandfather, who was a legitimate captain in his own right, had a penchant for sniffing cinnamon that many considered obsessive. Eventually, he built a fleet of spice trading ships that traveled the globe and made Salem one of the richest ports in the New World. Still, anyone would admit that it is the women of the Whitney family who have taken quirky to a new level of achievement. My mother, May, for example, is a walking contradiction in terms. A dedicated recluse who, with the exception of her arrests, hasn't left her home on Yellow Dog Island for the better part of 20 years. May has nevertheless managed to revive a long-defunct lace-making industry and to make herself famous in the process. She has gained considerable notoriety for rescuing abused women and children and turning their lives around, giving the women a place in her lace-making business and home-educating their children. All this from a raging agoraphobic who gave one of her own children to her barren half-sister Emma in a fit of generosity, because, as she said at the time, there was a need, and besides, she had been blessed with a matching set. And my great-aunt Eva, who is more mother to me than May ever has been, is equally strange. Running her own business well into her 80s, Eva is renowned as both Boston Brahmin and Salem Witch, when, really, she's neither. Actually, Eva is an old-school Unitarian with transcendentalist tendencies. She quotes scripture in the same breath as she quotes Emerson and Thoreau. Yet in recent years, Eva has spoken only in clichés, as if use of the tired metaphor can somehow remove her from the inevitable outcomes she is paid to predict. For 35 years of her life, Eva has run a ladies' tea room and franchised successful etiquette classes to the wealthy children of Boston's North Shore. But what Eva will be remembered for is her uncanny ability to read lace. People come from all over the world to be read by Eva, and she can tell your past, present, and future pretty accurately, just by holding the lace in front of you and squinting her eyes. In one form or another, all the Whitney women are readers. My twin sister, Lindley, said she couldn't read lace, but I never believed her. The last time we tried, she saw the same thing I saw in the pattern, and what we saw that night led her to the choices that eventually killed her. When Lindley died, I resolved never to look at a piece of lace again. This is one of the only things Eva and I have ever vehemently disagreed about. It wasn't that the lace was wrong, she always insisted. It was the reader's interpretation that failed. I know that's supposed to make me feel better. Eva never says anything to intentionally hurt. But Lindley and I interpreted the lace the same way that night, and though our choices might have been different, nothing that Eva says can ever bring my sister back. After Lindley's death, I had to get out of Salem and ended up in California, which was as far as I could go without falling off the end of the earth. I know that Eva wants me to come home to Salem. It's for my own good, she says. But I can't bring myself to do it. Just recently, when I had my hysterectomy, Eva sent me her lace pillow, the one she uses to make the lace. It was delivered to the hospital. What is it? My nurse asked, holding it up, staring at the bobbins and the piece of lace, a work in progress still attached to it. Some kind of pillow? It's a lace maker's pillow, I said, for making Ipswich lace. She regarded me blankly. I could tell she had no idea what to say. It didn't look like any pillow she had ever seen. And what the hell was Ipswich lace? Try holding it against your sutures if you have to cough or sneeze, she finally said. That's what we use pillows for around here. I felt around until I found the secret pocket hidden in the pillow. I slipped my fingers in, looking for a note. Nothing. I know that Eva hopes I will start reading lace again. She believes that lace reading is a God-given gift, and that we are required to honor such gifts. I imagine the note she might have written. Of those to whom much is given, much is expected. Luke 12:48. She used to quote that bit of scripture as proof. I can read lace, and I can read minds, though it isn't something I try to do. It is something that just happens sometimes. My mother can do both, but over the years, May has become a practical woman who believes that knowing what is in people's minds or their futures is not always in anyone's best interest. This is probably the only point upon which my mother and I have ever agreed. When I left the hospital, I stole the pillowcase off one of their pillows. The Hollywood Presbyterian label was double-stamped on both sides. I stuffed Eva's lace pillow inside, hiding the threads, the lace, and the bone-like bobbins that were swinging like tiny Poe pendulums. If there was a future for me, and I was not altogether certain there was, I wasn't going to risk reading it in the lace. Each reader must choose a piece of lace. It is hers for life. It might be a pattern handed down through the generations, or a piece chosen by the reader for its beauty and familiarity. Many readers prefer the handmade laces, particularly those of old Ipswich, or the laces made today by the women of Yellow Dog Island. The Lace Reader's Guide. Chapter 2. When the phone call comes in, I am dreaming of water, not the warm blues and greens of the California beach towns where I live now, but the dark New England Atlantic of my youth. In my dream, I am swimming to the moon. Like all dreams, it seems logical. The idea that there is no pathway between sea and moon never occurs. I swim my own combination, part breaststroke, part drown-proofing, slow and purposeful. A rhythm remembered from another lifetime. The movement is all efficiency, with just nose, ears, and eyes protruding above the water, mouth submerged. With each forward stroke, tiny waves of salt enter my open mouth, then recede again as I slow, mirroring the larger surrounding ocean. I swim for a long time, past Salem Harbor and the swells, past any sight of land at all. I swim until the sea becomes still and clear, too calm to be any real ocean. The light from the full dream moon etches a clear path on the black water, a road to follow. There is no sound save my own breath, slow and steady as I swim. This was once my sister's dream. Now it is only mine. The rhythm of movement gives way to a sound rhythm as the telephone rings again and then again. This is one of the only phones that actually rings anymore, and part of the reason I agreed to take this house-sitting job. It is the kind of phone we might have had on our island. That's the one interesting thing about what has happened to me. I am encouraged to rewrite my own history. In the history I am writing, May actually has a phone. My therapist, Dr. Fukuhara, is a Jungian. She believes in symbols and shadows, as do I. But my therapy has stopped for the time being. We have come to an impasse, was the way Dr. Fukuhara put it. I laughed when she said it, not because it was funny, but because it was the kind of cliché that my Aunt Eva would use. On the fourth ring, the answering machine picks up. The machine is old also, not as old as the phone, but the kind where you can screen calls and hear a little bit of the message before you decide whether it's worth it to actually speak to a live person. My brother's voice sounds tinny and too loud. I stretch to pick up, pulling the surgery stitches that are still inside me, the ones that haven't yet dissolved. What? I say. I'm sorry to wake you, Beezer says. I remember falling asleep on this couch last night, too tired to get up, hypnotized by the smell of night-blooming jasmine and the sound of Santana playing over the hill at the Greek. I'm sorry, he says again. I wouldn't have called you, but... But May's in trouble again. It's the only time Beezer ever calls these days. At last count, May has been arrested 6 times in her efforts to help abuse victims. Recently, my brother informed me that he'd put the number of the local bail bondsman on his speed dial. It's not May, he says. My throat tightens. It's Eva. Dead, I'm thinking. Oh, my God. Eva is dead. She's missing, Towner. Missing. The word has no meaning. Missing is the last word I expected to hear. Palm fronds clatter against the open window. It's already way too hot. Clear Santa Ana sky. Earthquake weather. I reach up to pull the window shut. The cat runs scratches across my legs as it lunges for the freedom of the canyon, leaping through the window as it slams, catching just a few tail hairs, the last trace of what was here just moments ago and is now gone. That fast. Immediately, the cat scratches on my legs begin to welt. Towner?
Yeah?
I think you'd better come home.
Yeah, I say. Yeah, okay.
It is called Ipswich lace, or bobbin lace, or bone lace. It is made on bolster pillows, held on the laps of the women. The pillows are round or elliptical, and most resemble the muffs that Victorian women later carried to keep their hands warm while riding in their carriages. Each woman makes her own pillow, and those pillows are as individual as the women themselves. In old Ipswich, the pillows were pieced together from bits of fabric, then stuffed with beech grass. The Lace Reader's Guide. Chapter 3. The Salem News has already picked up the story about Eva's disappearance. Elderly woman missing 10 days, and Lace Reader of Salem vanishes. Eva used to send me the Salem paper. It was around the time that May started making the headlines. For a while, I actually read them. My mother's clashes with the police over her tactics for saving abused women were becoming famous,
and made for good copy. Eventually, I stopped reading the papers and would leave them on the porch in their wrappers until my landlord would get fed up and take them to Santa Monica for recycling, or, if it was winter, roll them up tightly and burn them in her fireplace like logs. The papers speculate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.